You know, I've been reading the CBC message boards in recent days. Talk about young Fernandez representing Canada at the U.S. Open and Andreescu as well, and their influence of their parents, and in Fernandez's case, influence of their father, a positive influence on their career. Now, some of these comments are negative, basically saying, oh, well, they're going to choke in the long run, or they're going to collapse. But what if they don't? Like, Eugenie Bouchard was on a good pace, but it didn't work out. Her game is not as consistent as Fernandez and Andreescu. But I'm going to talk today about the last time, really, that a female tennis player made a major stir at the Grand Slam at international events. And this is a name that would ring a bell with a lot of Canadians over the age of 50, but if you're under 30, it might not. So today we're talking about the very talented and the very unheralded Caroline Bassett-Seguso. Now, I covered her in her early years. I still don't know how good of a tennis player she was, because she rose so quickly and she hit a certain pace as a top 20 tennis player. But unfortunately, her father, the great John F. Bassett, died around the same time she was ascending in her career, and it really hurt her. And I know it led to some physical problems we're going to be talking about right now. Now, Caroline Bassett-Seguso, born Caroline Catherine Bassett, is a former, again, Canadian pro tennis player. Now, Bassett is the daughter of sport franchise owner John F. Bassett and Susan Carling, and the granddaughter of media baron John Bassett, the original John Bassett, and politician and brewery executive John Carling. She was inducted into the Ontario Sports Hall of Fame in 2003. Now, she first came to major prominence by winning the Canadian Junior Indoor Tennis title in 1981. In 82, she was ranked number 2 junior player in the world after winning events in Tokyo and Taipei. That year, she also became the youngest winner of the Canadian Closed Championship at the age of 14. She won the title again in 83 and 86. By age 16, Bassett was Canada's top tennis player. Now, this is a very interesting thing. She was an actress. She was getting heavily profiled in the media, especially a key article in Sports Illustrated, I think in mid-1983, the same issue where Duran came back against David Moore to win the title. Now, at the same time, she had a successful second career as a fashion model, working for the world-famous Ford Modeling Agency. She also dabbled in acting, being promoted as one of the stars of a 1982 teen comedy, Spring Fever, and later appearing in a 1984 episode of the Canadian syndicated hit, The Littlest Hobo. Now, in 83, Bassett advanced to the quarterfinals of the Australian Open and won her first top-level singles titles in Pennsylvania. In 84, she reached the quarterfinals at the French Open and, in her best performance at a Grand Slam, the semifinals at the U.S. Open, where she defeated Elizabeth Smiley, Pascalie Paradis, Mima Yuskovich, Petra Deliz, and Hanna Manglikova, big upset, before losing to the great Chris Evert. She reached the French Open quarterfinals again in 86. She won her second top-level singles title in 87 at Strasbourg. Now, Bassett was named the WTA's most impressive newcomer in 83 and Canada's female athlete of the year in 83 and 85. During her career, Bassett again won a total of 2 top-level singles titles and 2 doubles crowns. Now, located primarily in Boca Raton, Florida, but for most of her career, the 5'6" athlete again eventually retired in 1988. Now, noted for a wicked right-handed two-handed backhand as well. Now, she won nearly $650,000 in her career. In singles play, she won 168 and 112 with 2 WTA crowns, and the highest ranking, of course, was the infamous number 8 on March 4th, 85, where it made national news in Canada. Now, she made the quarterfinals of the 83 Australian Open, quarterfinals in the French, 84 and 86, Wimbledon in the fourth round, 83 and 86, and U.S. Open in 84 semifinals. She also played at the 88 Olympics when tennis was brought back for Team Canada, but unfortunately lost in the first round. Now, in doubles play, she went 77 and 79 with a myriad of partners, 2 WTA titles, and the highest ranking for doubles was 51st on January 19, 1987. Now, for the doubles at the Grand Slams, she was quarterfinals of Australian Open in 84, third round of French in 87. She was made it to the second round of Wimbledon, 83, 84, 85, 87. And at the U.S. Open in 85, she made the quarters. Now, the Olympics, she was quarterfinals in 88. Now, Grand Slam mixed double results. Australian Open, she was second round in 87. Best in the French Open, the quarterfinal in 83. Wimbledon, the third round in 84. And U.S. Open, second round in 86 and 88. Now, we knew there were some physical problems going on during his career, but we didn't know what it was. We were noticing some weight issues. And following her tennis career, she came out admitting she struggled for years with eating disorder bulimia. It becomes part of your life, like smoking, she told people in 92. Or it's like being an alcoholic. It's so easy to get into and so hard to get out of. I hated myself that I couldn't stop. Now, Bassett eventually married American tennis player Robert Seguso in 87. The couple have five children, two sons and three daughters. Holden John Seguso, daughter Carling Jr., Ridley Jack, Lennon Chai, and the youngest, Theodora. Holden has played in a handful of futures tennis tournaments, off and on, since 2005. Now, on Monday, August 13, 2007, during the Canadian Open Tennis Championships at Rexall in Toronto, along with John McEnroe, was inducted in the Canadian Tennis Hall of Fame. After the ceremony, Bassett teamed up with U.S. tennis great Jim Courier for a friendly doubles match against John McEnroe and Anna Kournikova. Now again, just to recap the singles titles, first came at Hershey in February of 83, beating Sandy Collins 2-6, 6-0, 6-4. She made the finals in Palm Springs in 83, Amelia Island in 83, Honolulu in 83, and Tampa in 84, and won Strasbourg over Sandra Shishini with a 6-3, 6-4 victory. Now, doubles titles, her first doubles titles came at Hard Court of Tampa in October 84, as her and partner Elizabeth Sayers knocked off Mary Lou Daniels and Wendy White. And, of course, the most famous for a lot of people, the great Gabriella Sabatini teamed with her on Tampa's Hard Court in November 85. They defeated Lisa Bonder and Laura Gilmaster in an impressive 6-0 and 6-0. So at the Grand Slam, Australian Open, she 83, she was in the quarterfinal, lost in the first round in 84, and was in the fourth round in 87. Now, French Open, quarterfinals in 84 and 86, fourth round in 85 and third round in 87. Wimbledon, fourth round between 83 and 87, fourth round, third round, second round, fourth round, first round, first round. U.S. Open, third round, semifinal, fourth round, first round, second round in 87, third round in 88. Very consistent at the U.S. Open. Won a lot of matches. So year-end rankings, 82 to 1990, 95th, 20th, 11th, 15th, 20th. Again, top 20 for four straight years. 31st, then 147, 158, and 147. So again, a well-deserving member of the Ontario Sports Hall of Fame. Again, part of an era where Canadian tennis was, not say still in its modern infancy, but she broke a lot of ground because she was well-respected by the American press, but the pressure that was on her, and John passing away from brain cancer. Hit the family pretty hard and hit the Canadian sports scene very hard because, as you know, he was heavily involved in the USFL, heavily involved in the WHA. The USFL was a great success down in Florida because of him. And, Carling, not to say she was a Valley girl, but Sports Illustrated stressed the fact she was your typical young teen. She was, playful, energetic. And I really don't know how much pressure she felt within the Canadian media. I know in American media maybe a little bit more, but, why a person turns to bulimia or drugs or whatever, her struggles were her own. All I'm saying, I watched her play a very, very strong game, but I think at 5'6", the larger European players that she played against, she had some difficulty. She could compete with her typical American, you know, size and energy like she had. But I found she was extremely good on the baseline. She's extremely good on the serve. And, you know, she was one of those, young prospect kids that were coming up in the 1980s. And there's quite a few. But you see who came out of that era, you know, later, like Jim Courier, Steffi Graf, the young kids. This was when tennis was changing. It was no longer dominated by the Americans, the European side. Obviously, you had Martina was still around, Chris Evert was still around, but Monica Seles was right around the corner, Steffi was around the corner, Boris Becker. It was getting to be more of an international game, and she was a trailblazer. All I know is that CTV broke into regular programming. She was playing in a tennis event, I think it was a fourth round or fifth round in a big one in the States. It's the first time she advanced, and CTV interrupted her programming to show it. And I think it was a simulcast with ESPN or one of the myriad of cable channels at the time. But from 1982, again, to about 1986, it was a great time. Because you turn on the TV, and Carling was always doing something. She was doing well at the big events. And again, your typical strong top 20 player of the time. So anyway, I wish her great success. She gave a lot to Canada. She left it all on the court. And, she built a great family for herself, still very close with her siblings and the family. And I'm very proud to say that I should have done a podcast on her before, because I consider her a top 30 female athlete of the 1980s for Canada. And she came literally very close to getting to the Grand Slam. So when Andreescu bet Serena, my thoughts went back to against Carling Bassett, because she paved the way of what he called the modern era of North American tennis. And again, an outstanding athlete and one of the most underrated athletes in Canadian history, in my personal opinion. Thanks for listening. If you like what we're doing here, give us a like, comment, subscribe, and keep your stick in the ice. Bye.